Hello viewers, I am your mentor Muhammad Tariq. In the last video, we had gone down to the direct method of ranging, in which we had used ranging rods that were three in number, and we had adjusted our location for ranging purpose. In this video, we will conduct direct ranging with the help of a line ranger. We also have an indirect method, and this direct or indirect ranging is used finally for taking chain surveying up, or rather conducting chain surveying in the field with the help of arrow and a chain, and we compute the area of a plot, etc. So we'll put the maximum focus of using a line ranger in this video. It is one of the minor instruments that we use, and it is quite helpful. Later in the next video, we will go along with the usage of a cross staff and how we use a cross staff in order to put a 90-degree angle. So, talking about the direct method, the purpose is to measure the distances with the help of a chain tape on the ground. We use the method of direct ranging and also the method of indirect. So, a bit about chain surveying. It is derived from the principle of triangulation, and the area is divided into triangle, rectangles, polygons, and the area of these triangles, rectangles, polygons, squares, etc. are taken and added up to find the area of the plot that is available. So this is a small focus about the chain surveying. Like I had explained the last video, that we select two points A and B. A is next to you and B is the far end, and within them we have many intermediate points that are selected, which are taken up for ranging, and these points are established with the help of a ranging rod. Now we are going to study about the ranging. So the ranging process over here that we had conducted was with a naked eye, and we were not using any apparatuses or minor major instrument for the purpose of ranging. Minimum of three ranging rods were required to complete the procedure of ranging. Here we shall be using only two ranging rods. So here we have two kinds of ranging, one being the direct ranging and the other being the indirect, or it is also called reciprocal ranging. We'll pick this up in the other video. Right now in the direct ranging, we again have two procedures. One is by the eye method that we have conducted in the last video, and Here we will be discussing about the line range and the procedure adopted in the line ranger method for performing the ranging. So this is the procedure that we have conducted by I in the last one, and I'll just be skipping this up. You can go through it. If you feel like, you'll find this on the block. And here is the photograph or the figure that shows the procedure of direct ranging. So we'll directly now get down to the line ranger. So here in the figure, you can see how a line ranger looks like. This is the point where we look at. Inside this, there are two glasses which reflect the ranging rod's images, and here is the image that is being formed over here. This is the point A where the first ranging rod is, and the line B where the second ranging rod is. Right in the center you have the line ranger, that is this apparatus over here, which with the help of which you will look at the lines that have to be in a straight line. Now right over here is shown the incorrect alignment or the incorrect position of the lines of the ranging rod whose reflection is seen in the line ranger. When these two ends meet, that is the line over here and the line over here, in this other figure it meets over here. So you drop a perpendicular right onto the ground from this point. It is held vertical. So you drop a point right onto the ground, and right over there you can place a ranging rod. So this is how we use a line ranger. I'll explain the procedure in detail with the help of a line diagram. As you can see in the figure, we have a ranging rod at point A and a ranging rod B at this point. The surveyor stands at this location, somewhere midway between A and B, or as required. This is the diagram that is being formed in the line ranger. Here you can see right over here that there is a ray that is passing over here, and the other ray that is coming from this side. That is, from one comes from A side and the other comes from B side, meeting at the point R over here. So this is the center position or the center location where it meets, right in the center over here. So when these two edges meet over here at this particular junction or at this particular point, then our line is ranged, and from here you can drop a vertical over here. It is being shown in the figure right over here that the vertical is being drawn over here by the surveyor. So you have got to just look at the point that they meet in the line ranger. You find the reflection in the line ranger and you adjust the line ranger in such a way that these two rays coming from the opposite direction meet in the line ranger. So this is a very, very minor instrument, and this is very, very important, and it helps a lot reducing or carrying heavy loads. This work can be performed with the help of heavy apparatuses as well. But this is something that you can carry in your pocket. With this, you can easily conduct the experiment or the ranging at the site. So here, in the next slide, the details that I have discussed before has been repeated. So I'll just go to the major parts, that we fix the rods P and Q, and between P and Q I have an intermediate point, and this intermediate point is R over here. So this R point is maintained right in the center, or as required. Then finally we coincide these two rays, or the meeting of the rays are transferred to the ground, and this is how that the ranging is completed. So next we will be coming up with the cross staff and the use of a cross staff in ranging in order to provide a 90 degree angle before we proceed to the other parts of survey. I hope I've been able to explain you, and my best wishes to you all.